Welcome everybody to the IMSC Algebraic Combinatorics Seminar. It's a great pleasure to have again Krishnan Rajkumar from Jawaharlal Nehru University. He's going to talk about Selberg integrals involving Schur polynomials and combinatorial connections. Krishnan, please.
Hey, thank you very much for the second invitation. I hope to do better than last time. Let's anyway share the screen. That's the most I will do. To waste time with yeah, so let me start at the beginning. Okay, how do I? Yes, it works, kind of works. Okay, so wrote it all down in this staircase fashion. So hopefully I'll do these in this order, but I'll focus a lot more on the combinatorial connection. So we did spend a bit of time last time. So I'll just recall mildly what Jack polynomials were, though they may not necessarily be the, I mean, the results may not, our results may not be as general as we need, but I would like to always indicate the generalization possible. So at that stage, so I'll basically be dealing with Schur functions, Schur polynomials most of the time. But this is this vast generalization of them due to Jack, of course, but studied by McDonald, Stanley, and then Cadell, and many of these people have contributed. So this is one compact definition. Of course, it's implicit always. So it's best to understand that, A and B put together looks like this. You start with the inner product on space of all, let's say, polynomials with symmetric polynomials. You are the experts here. So if you start with the inner product on those, defined as follows. So P lambda is this power sum symmetric polynomials. And P lambda, P mu are generally assumed to be orthogonal now, not orthonormal, as it was in the usual inner product. So the weight, when P lambda with respect to P lambda, the inner product is given by this function of alpha. So alpha was generally assumed to be a real number. I suppose it's not necessarily positive. Is again my supposition, but I would prefer that it's always positive. We will generally deal with the case when alpha is 1. So whatever it is, this is the way in which the inner product has been defined. And then you do the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization, let's say, of M lambda. So you start with the basis M lambda, but then you do the Gram-Schmidt process without, you know, normalization, just make it orthogonal, and you get to this stage where you get your Jack polynomials, just parameterized to alpha. This is the most compact definition. There are several other definitions, like later on we'll see, but for the time being, you can think of it as a vast generalization and or an interpolation even of all our favorite symmetric functions, like E lambda, which was at 0. Of course, at 1 was the Schur functions themselves. That's where it all started, I suppose. I'm not at all sure of the history. And of course, as alpha tends to infinity, you get back your M lambda. And these are special cases which don't even seem to depend on alpha, where if you take the... So this lambda is a partition of... if you have to stick to the number of variables being n, then this is a partition of at most n parts, lambda. And here, if you take the partition 1, 1, 1, r times, r being less than equal to n, then you get your elementary symmetric function in one integer. How do you put it? It's not the e lambdas that we are kind of referring to. That was here. When you let alpha tend to 0, but if you fix this, and for any alpha it seems to be fixed, And of course, you get your HR also in a sort of dual fashion with a lot of details. So another way to define it is, of course, this Peary rule. So this is just like this Shure function. So there are several ways of defining them. So this is another way which Stanley had discovered. Again, it is all seems to be close to the 1987 mark. There are several papers that got published around that time. So this is one of those rules which you are familiar with. Again, there has been several talks in the seminar series. So anyway, it seems to follow the same pattern, where if you say P lambda alpha times ER, fixed R, let's say, then R an integer, positive integer. So it's actually the sum over all the mu's, bigger ones, which are when you skew, the skew shape, V minus lambda, I really don't know how to say it, V minus lambda maybe, is a vertical R strip. So only R boxes you have to add in one below the other. I mean, not necessarily exactly below, but yeah, overall R boxes added to lambda in some fashion, one below the other. No two in one row. So once you get all those mu's, definitely you have a explicitly defined rational function. Generally, I've written it in blue here. We'll talk about this later. Product of some upper and lower hook length connected with mu and lambda. But it's not one as it was in the Shure case. It's not just a product, it's a ratio also. So it's a rational function. I wrote product, sorry. So overall, there are several ways to define DAC polynomials. And we would love to have a nice seminar on on them. Yeah, we had a, I'm sure you had a plan for that. But we'll focus on these integrals, which are like kind of generalizations of the Selberg integrals. So for that, we just stick to this weight function, which is product of xi to the alpha minus 1 and 1 minus x. So it's just some sort of generalization of the beta weight function in beta density or whatever you would like to call it, some probability theory or even special functions. So it's a symmetric version, which is like fixed powers of alpha of xi and 1 minus xi. And this quantity, the delta function, is also like you might have referred to it as, is it A delta? Yeah, it is A delta. Xi to the n minus 1 minus j, ij going from 0 to n minus 1. So, I mean, there was this famous delta, which I will still write here only. Delta is this standard partition, staircase, sorry. I would like to really don't know the notation. But delta is this partition, which is all distinct parts, 0 to n minus 1. And this could also be thought of as delta j, if you like. So xi to the delta j is your van der Mond determinant. That's exactly what we wanted to refer to. But here we will just call it delta in this talk. I have just gone through a bit of confusion whether it is j minus I or I minus j. I think I resolved it and wrote it down here. But it doesn't really matter in the definition of the integral, because we are having a modulus sign, which is, so basically alpha, beta, gamma are even allowed to be complex numbers. Now this is going to be beyond us for time being. Let's just stick to the real ones and with suitable, you know, restrictions, alpha bigger than beta, bigger, real part of alpha, beta and gamma bigger than certain quantities, so that this integral converges. And what's the integral? Written here very clearly. It's the DAC polynomial with this parameter. So this parameter is tightly linked to the delta, power of the delta. Unfortunately, there's probably no way to, I mean, we haven't yet been able to get out of this link. They seem to be tightly linked, but alpha and beta can vary as they wish in some sense. And you integrate it, and what you get is some nice nice product or ratio of gamma factors. So this was the generalization of what Selberg himself had discovered so long back. We have seen this history, etc. But if you just stick to gamma, we have seen it, haven't we? So this is the lambda zero case. When there is no partition at all, you really don't care about this p lambda at all. And so many of these factors just vanish, and you just have what is left here is the Selberg integral without the lambdas, this alpha, beta, and gamma. The n factorial seems to be, if the lambdas are zero,
without the w, it's just some beta integral, right?
Without the w,
it's related. Well, this is x to a minus one.
If
one
the
minus
gamma is
to b minus one, there's only one variable.
You mean if a gamma is zero or something?
I guess that corresponds to gamma zero.
So the gamma zero case is the beta integral in many variables. So it's a power of the beta integral. I suppose you'll get that if gamma is zero and lambda is zero, etc.
Gamma factors.
But definitely, it's the generalization of beta integral. That's how Selberg had.
And if you put alpha equals beta equals one, then you're just integrating the random to some power.
Exactly. So that is the case we'll be dealing with in the remaining, most of the part of the remaining lecture. When alpha and beta are one, these factors don't come into play. We really bothered about delta only.
And we discussed this last time, but we don't really know how to decompose delta to the two gamma in terms of
Symmetric functions, right? Yeah. You don't, I never knew in the first place. I didn't check after that, sorry. If you have also not really looked at it, right?
But it's a special case of the it's a kind of Littlewood-Richardson coefficient. Right,
it will be, that's terribly interesting. When Selberg was doing his proof, he was dealing with k being integers and he could decompose it. It seemed to have a very nice decomposition. He used it in his proof, but not in other cases. It must be having some
coefficient involving some triangular shape.
I will be really interested in discussing this later on with you.
Sure, yeah.
So this is like terribly exciting stuff. But I might have more to say about the Littlewood-Richardson rule. Similar such vague, as vague as this. So, okay. Now this approach is fixed. Okay, let me not show you so much on the screen. Let's make it a little bit better. Okay, this is too big. So anyway, I'm focusing on this determinant and I'm going to see if I can derive this integral, whatever we have seen till now. A word about Kedel's proof. Kedel used the Pierre rule. So he used it inductively. Just like we would define the Jack polynomials, he would define the integral. So it was the same way in which he managed to prove this using the Pierre rule. And so some part of what I discussed last time was some sort of, how to do it by induction. But anyway, let's leave it last time. Here is a determinantal approach, which might be more interesting to all of you. So we start with an integral, a determinant of entries, which are all integrals. And integrals, so they have a one variable, which is 3y, one as in a set of y1 to yn, but these xi's are actually in the integrals. So for the sake of, neatness, I just labeled xi's, but we really didn't care about them. It was just to be integrated out. Only this yi remains. So we do it in two ways. First, one way is we pull out all the integrals row-wise. So I labeled each variable by the row and pulled out as in totally justified because of the limiting sum nature, blah, blah, blah. So we can pull out the integral, like we pull out the sums also later on. But these are also like in sums in the limit. So what happens?
Just one clarification. this in the determinant, the I's and J's are the same I and J. I mean, Xi to the I, is that same I?
Yes, yes, it's the same I. So basically, the dependence on I, if you look at it, is to the variable yi and to, yeah, this power xi.
Okay.
I mean, the integral should have been written by like s or something like that. It doesn't really depend on what the variable is which you're integrating out.
Yeah.
But these powers are important, yes. I and j are the powers, and of course, yi we have left p.
So yi power j comes outside the integral, right? So the only dependence on j is through yi to the power j,
yes,
which comes outside the integral.
Comes outside the integral, yes.
So it's something depending, some constant basically. No, something that depends
on yi power j comes out of the integral, but yeah, yi remains inside the integral in some other fashion. It's a polylogarithm that comes up if you really want to go to the special function interpretation.
Okay.
Polylogarithm depending on something.
Okay, thanks.
But I'm going to keep it inside so that I can play around with it. So in one sense, I pull out the integral and I put the data, as you said, dependence on J is only through the yi. So the determinant just falls here. The rest all just come out of the determinant. And this is what I wanted to just say. This is, of course, our van der Mond. I mean, this is not the van der Mond. If it had been N1, so for the time being, you might have to bear with me. It's wrong, the sign. There's a sign that has to come here, but I will change the integral now. I'll change the determinant, sorry, for making, this was just for the illustrative purpose and because I was confused initially. But let's say this is some sign plus minus, okay, let me write it here, plus minus delta y, this one, van der Mond determinant, and then we go ahead with it. But if on the other hand, if you had just expanded this geometric series, done the integration, the geometric series is summation xi yi to the power ki minus 1, let's just say, because I have started from 1. Or ki, if you, whatever you wanted to say, you could have integrated it out. You would have had xi to the power ki plus I, and when you integrate it, this comes to the bottom. It's 0 to 1. So having done all that, then we could have pulled out the sums, and we would get this to this stage. So that's why there's this ki minus 1, because I'm just, for convenience sake, going from 1 to infinity. If it was 0 to infinity, there would have been a plus 1 here and nothing there. So this is literally yi ki by ki plus I. And of course, there is again a delta y because yi to the j plus minus. The same plus minus comes on both sides. So maybe it's not so crucial. Maybe I'll not change anything. Otherwise, I would have written delta I here in both places. Delta is n plus minus one. That would have resolved all of our confusion. But we could just continue with the confusion. Whatever sign is there, it's the same on both places. So what we then do in order to make life interesting is to symmetrize this. So where sigma acts on, this is literally f of y sigma 1, f of y sigma 2, etc. So I permute the y's and take the average over the symmetric group, overall permutation. So then it finally becomes a symmetric function in y. How does that help us? So that's where it looks long. But it's a nice thing. So I'm just assuming it's a positive sign that's coming up. You could ignore, if it was negative, it would have been same on both sides. So we could have canceled it. So what do we get here? So when we permute this, when we permute the y's, delta y acts as an alternating, gets the alternating sign, as in for odd permutations it will be negative and for even permutations it will be positive. while the overall modulus will remain the same. So what I claim is, when you add it over all permutations, we get what is the determinant of 1 minus xi yj. So y's are getting permuted and the appropriate sign is also coming up. You add it all up, it's a determinant. If that step is fine, then we go on, because that's the Cauchy determinant and that has this neat formula you discovered, Cauchy and many others rediscovered. And this is like such a neat formula. So now delta y comes with a square, of course, but there's a delta x term that remains. So we could exploit that. And again, you know, average over all the permutations of xi. And the delta x and xi, therefore, combine to give another determinant of xi to the j. And that's another delta x. So literally, we reach to this stage without moving a muscle, I would say. So this is the final state we reach. Of course, we expand it later on, but let's don't look at the expansion. What happens on the other side is, so you had yi to the ki and ki plus i. And once we permuted y's, of course, as we said, the sign comes up here. So it becomes a determinant of yj to the ki minus 1. I mean, y's are getting permuted and there's a sign that comes up. You add it all up. So this is related to the Schur polynomial. It's related to this specific thing if k's were arranged in the decreasing order. If k1, I mean, it is not, it's all sorts of things. But if k1 was bigger than, if k1, if this was to be true, then of course this determinant is the, as we say, Schur polynomial. So Schur polynomial I did not define, sorry. Somewhere I should have written. That's one, sorry, has come up. S lambda is, how do I put it? Determinant. I should have written A lambda and all that. But yeah. What? Oh, lambda. No. Lambda I plus delta I. By, of course, delta. But as we know this very well, so it's a ratio of these two determinants. So literally what comes up here is what I have tried to write down here. So this is sum of this thing and delta. So it's, of course, if it was this, then it would have been perfectly equal. But what if it was jumbled? Then of course, what we would get is another sign of the permutation that converts k into this form. This is very non-standard notation, but I have just written it down here quickly. This is the sign of the permutation that transforms k1 to kn, whatever random indices, into this ordered set. So finally, what do we get out of all that? So if you had just kept this ordered thing, it would have been a sum over all the signs, and the k dependence is only here. This is a symmetric function. We are just leaving it. We're not dealing with it. This is what I meant by this is the modulus and the sign. We keep this, and what we get is actually a determinant of this kj plus i. If you're still okay with it, this is again a Cauchy determinant. And you get...
I'm not sure what that S subscript k minus 1 minus delta.
This was this Schur polynomial, which was, you know, as you were... I mean, we are all familiar with this.
Oh,
and
k
I
minus
didn't,
1.
Didn't introduce this notation.
No, just what is that k minus 1 minus 1?
What is k minus 1? So, okay. As in, okay, yeah.
Oh, just k minus 1 as one part partition?
Yeah. Okay. No. Not one part. It's
k minus one. Everything is k minus.
Everything is individual ki minus one minus delta I.
So because of that determinant being the numerator.
Yes. Because we have this thing, we are calling this something plus delta.
Yeah.
And that's something I just wrote it down here.
Ki.
And
minus.
No.
These k's are strictly decreasing.
So the sign basically comes up if they are not. And finally, you keep this, but the sign goes and combines with our ki plus I, and you get a determinant here.
Okay, got it. Otherwise,
it's not a Schur function. It's a signed version
up
of
to
a
sign,
Schur
function. Yeah.
Up to sign. And that sign we are crucially capturing, if you notice, into putting it into the determinant. And once you have this, we have this final form. So this final form is like easily produced, but here we need to get one step further. So here we got this nice integral, but how do you write it as a sum over partitions? We use the McDonald's identity, which is product ij 1 minus xi yj is sum over lambda s lambda x s lambda y.
This is the Cauchy identity.
Sorry. So what about that one? That's also called the Cauchy's determinant. Okay.
Discovered more than one identity.
Yeah. I'm eating my heart out now. Anyway, McDonald also discovered something similar, but that was for the Jack polynomial, I think. Anyway, which we will talk about later. So, using this, we just expand out blah, 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 and we get this. So what is this? Lambda is a sum over all partitions with parts less than equal to n, at most n, where we fix the number of variables, 1 to n, right, variables. So lambda is, so what we finally conclude after all this. So basically now we see that in terms of y, there's this sum over Schur polynomials, if you forget about this delta y squared, both sides. Sum over Schur polynomial, so you can literally equate the coefficient in this ring. And is it a completely formal proof? I don't know. I'm sure it can be made into a convergence. But right now it's formal. Let's just go with it. So what we finally conclude that this integral is actually a product of this form. Why is n factorial? There was an n factorial here down. This was it. And of course, this is actually going to be equal to the Kettle integral. I'll just show you what it is. So Kettle integral was looking somewhat like this. So when you put
delta of delta,
I'll just tell you.
You had a couple of delta terms.
Couple of delta. So I'll just tell you that. So that is where the hook lengths come in, but I haven't written anything down. I'll hand wave. But without hook lengths, it's right here. If you just put gamma is 1, which is what you need for the Schur symmetric function, and alpha, beta 1, we had already understood. If alpha and beta 1, this factor goes off, it's just delta x power 2, which is what we have down below. And if you put gamma is 1, you have your Schur function here. Okay. So alpha and beta are 1, and gamma was also 1. So this will be a product of factorials, basically. 1 factorial, 2 factorial, 3 factorial. And this one is lambda plus 1 plus, you can see that. And here it's lambda plus 1 plus, there's a 2n, unfortunately, that's the only big D in the denominator. So at one stage, there is a ratio of lambda and there's a product of factorials here. And what's going to happen here, it's just going to be, so if you just put gamma as 1, the ratio of two gamma functions, it's just separated by 1. So in the in our Kedel's own notation, this was what he had said it was. J minus I gamma and gamma. whatever that means. This is the what? Rising factorial. So anyway, when you put gamma as one, it's just this number. This is all that you get out of this whole business. It's lambda I minus plus j minus means lambda I minus lambda j plus j. So anyway, where are we here? We are at a stage. I wrote lambda here and k here. So what is this k? K is actually lambda plus one plus delta. So literally we have lambda. Okay, what happened to my, I hope I have, it happened last time too. Amazing. So ki is lambda I. No, minus I. That's delta. And this is, so this is literally, what's that? Lambda I plus N minus I. That's ki. And if you have a delta k, what do we get actually? So now you will get it actually. Lambda I plus N minus I minus lambda j plus, N plus j. So this is exactly that term, that this delta k. So this is basically when the n's cancel off, you do get what you had above. Okay. So delta k literally is this term from Kedel's integral. And these are of course coming from the Selberg ones, but that is kind of taken care of here. So you do have, you have everything here, and this is the extra factor that came. There was an n factorial which somehow needed to be taken care of. Okay, so but the question is, I've written it as a question because my fervent hope, or the wish list actually, all these questions. This method, we did manage to prove something. I have to see the time. How much time do I have actually?
It's just 2:30.
Just 2:30. Amazing. I didn't expect, but I cannot get rid of anything. Okay, sorry. Yeah. So fine. We have managed to prove the Kedel integral for gamma equal to 2. Now, it may seem like a very trivial statement, but I have seen several experts in the field doing similar things for results involving Jack polynomials. I hope they are not in the audience, but even if they were, they would agree that gamma equal to 1 is a special case, and it seems to have a lot of value to actually write down the proofs. But my question would actually be, if we can somehow make this work for general gamma. So the main issues that we would have would be this Cauchy's determinant, first thing. If you have a higher power of, if you were to keep, I mean, in what, so first thing, sorry. Alpha and beta is not the big deal here. If I had just started out with xi to the alpha, I mean, if I just said alpha plus I for that matter, then it would just go through and you would easily have a, I mean, it would be just k plus lambda I plus alpha. It would just add up to the lambda I or k, whatever you wish to say. There's no big deal and it would be okay. And beta case we will talk about later. So even beta can be handled. But the gamma is the issue and it's still open. Let's not waste a little bit more time. So the main thing would be that we do have a version of we this is we as in McDonald has this identity where it's a ratio of two hook lengths, so some constant times, and I wrote this down last time. Sorry, I have to look at it. Yeah, 1 by gamma. It is 1 by gamma indeed. So there is a nice straightforward generalization of this identity. We would have loved to have a gamma in this denominator, but then how to produce it? It would have had to come from a determinant, and the Cauchy's determinant doesn't seem to generalize so well for higher powers. It does generalize to the square. That's about it. Rest are all open. So, well, I hope to have some better solutions when I give a talk to this seminar next time. If you will call me. Okay, variations on the theme. This is the best part. So now we have done all the hard work. We can just go through the consequences. What if we had instead started with mu I, not delta I, but mu I, some random permutation, which is, of course, you know, distinct parts, permutation of distinct parts. So I just called it nu plus delta, so that it's nu is any permutation with at most n parts. Delta was the staircase. So you do get all distinct parts in the mu i's. What do you get? So it's just so straightforward, actually. We get this nice, neat formula for a product of two root functions. Now, if we thought that it hadn't been done before, no. Many people have worked on it, including Hua and Cadell themselves. So this Hua thing, at least that little bit of history I would like to say, Cadell always refers, it's only Cadell who started the tradition of referring to Hua. And I went and read the book, which Hua had written, it was in the 50s. Extremely well-written book, but I couldn't find a single place where he mentions either shoot functions or Jack polynomials. Maybe I'll have to read it with an eagle eye. But Cadell has many of these results in his papers. So this is one of them, where they do have a product and they have a nice integral, which again factors, etc. And this is the way in which they have shifted it to beta by gamma minus one. In our case, we haven't shifted anything at all. So it's like, yeah. Beta. The one case we are able to handle. I checked that. Of course, we get back to it. But do we have anything more in the lined up? It would be nice to know. But at the very least, if S lambda, what was I about to say? So I wanted to say that already Amri had asked about the Littlewood Richardson coefficient. So there is some hint of that coming up here already. If S lambda and S mu, the product was actually a sum over shoot functions themselves, those coefficients will have to, like, you know, see these numbers here and these numbers here. They will have to have the same relation. So we should be able to either one thing to say is, one statement would be, can we derive the Littlewood Richardson coefficients just from these rules? And my hope is actually that it can be done. At least theoretically, it can be done. But practically, maybe, again, next time you call me. Or if it is interesting to any of you.
You're saying that there's an algorithm to do it from these rules.
If there were some coefficients. So what would
expand the left-hand side.
And then we would have to solve over various lambdas in use. Basically, we know the right hand side well.
Yeah.
So we should be able to do it. Now, if it can be done, only we will come to know if we do. So that part is left. But I would have, this is more interesting. As in, this is of course interesting enough, but this is even more interesting, where if you started out with a 1 minus x, so this is where the beta part comes in. If you had just said 1 minus x power beta I, blah, 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 and it could have easily come up into the, so the Kedel part could have been reproduced if you just put an extra 1 minus x to the beta in each integral. But what if you had said 1 minus x to the mu I? What do we get out of this? The rigmarole. So what, this is what we get. So we get that S lambda S mu 1 minus x. So now this is even more interesting because I didn't ever tell you. In my hurry, I did not even write it down. So 0, 1, etc. is the same. We know. Yeah, it's the same as, I mean, there's nothing to even think about here. By the integral itself, there's a symmetry in x for the remaining, x going to 1 minus x. The integral is symmetric with respect to that. So transformation would actually give you this. But then this, what do you know about S lambda 1 minus x as a sum over S lambda? I mean, S, I don't know, mu? This is a symmetric function. And you can even expand it from the, using the, what's that called? The Jacobi's identity, A lambda, A delta, but it's for 1 minus x. 1 minus x is the same. So if you had expanded this determinant, you would be able to conclude various, expand every entry-wise. You would definitely be able to get these coefficients. What I was going to say is, I was going to say something. Yeah. Suppose I'll say it is C lambda nu. Suppose these are the coefficients that come up. Then what does this mean? This means that C lambda nu of I lambda, let's just call it I lambda, this a Kedel integral. I mean, do you get it? Sorry, do you get it? I knew, right? Yeah. So if you had expanded this out, put it into the integral and then integrated it, what would you have got? You would have got this sort of equation. So literally it means that these, I knew are eigen vectors of a matrix, and that itself would be able to okay, I'm a little lost here, but it does tell you something about this. I was about to conclude that these are non-negative. Of course, when you expand, you get all sorts of negative and positive, but the fact that this is non-negative and combinatorial, hopefully I wanted to ask the experts if this is a well-known result. If the Schur function of 1 minus x has a combinatorial, it has a combinatorial interpretation for the sum.
So putting 1 minus x is like filling the tableau either with a negative thing with the number or with leaving it blank.
So there will be a, you are sure there will be a...
No.
Okay.
No, I'm just wondering, thinking aloud.
Okay.
This, I haven't seen this. Maybe there are other experts here.
Sure. But this is one of those silly questions I would have written question 2. But question 3 is more interesting, where we actually see that when you do this integral, you get a definite combinatorial interpretation. This is the erstwhile promised skew shape, blah, blah, blah. So here it is. What it is this, there's this determinant. It's not a nice product formula. Still, there is a determinant and it has a interpretation of this form. Suppose we had reordered the columns, j going to n plus 1 minus j, then you would have got it in this form. You would have got the determinant that you see here in the form, which was well suited for counting the number of standard Young tableau of skew shape R minus S, divided by, of course, a very huge factorial, the number of boxes in this, which is, I would say, kind of when you sum over lambda, then you, it's not the most important thing in our kitty. Here it is. So the R's are partitions got from lambda, and SJ's are, of course, got from mu, and this is the way it looks. So, of course, you have this square of size n by n extra added, so it loses all its, for those who love skew shapes in all their generality, this is not so general. There's this huge square sitting inside it, but on the other side is lambda, and on this side it's this inverted lambda rotated. Mm-hmm. This kind of thing, of course, I've seen it in literature, but I mean shapes, but I have not necessarily of course, this is not, I have not seen this in literature. This doesn't come from Alba, Khatib, Lipinov. So this is actually, these are physicists who work in conformal field theory. This kind of thing comes up a lot in their work. But if you put beta as zero, of course you get x minus one or one minus x, but then this goes for a toss actually. They don't converge and it's not the same as what they get. So what we get is something new. And of course they have a nice, beautiful product formula and we don't. So definitely we have reached a limiting case of theirs, which is outside their limit. And what would I say this tells us? This tells us that all that we have seen before are all hook length formulas. These are all like the cases where, let's say for example, mu is zero. When mu is zero, this it becomes a nice, perfect shape. I mean, proper shape. Number of SYTs, hook length. We know that there's a hook length formula for this, and that seems to be what we should have got from this. There's a nice product formula. Is this a hook length formula? So I would have done more calculations and shown you that yes, it is. As in, straight out of McDonald's books only. So you can interpret this as a product of hooking. This one especially, yes. So there is a way in which we can interpret parts of this, with the appropriate parts of this, as hooking formula. So what does that tell us? I mean, this is kind of like, isn't it? Sorry, I'm not exactly. But it seems to be very much obvious to me. I might be very naive that the Selberg integral and these Kedel integrals have proper combinatorial interpretation, which has not yet been explored in literature, definitely. And then the other one, this one also can be interpreted in some sort of fashion. I am not, this is much more out of the way, but this is definitely has a nice combinatorial. So now what is the question? The question is, okay, we do have hook length formulas, but we do have the combinatorial interpretation, but do we have a way to use or derive hook length formulas for these? Means nice, sum of nice products. So of course we had seen, so now this is a part where I have not written anything down. So there is something due to Narus, and of course popularized a lot by several papers, I mean by the collaboration of these people. one of them should be speaking next week. And anyway, this is something like this SYT is a sum over several excited diagrams. I mean, sum over excited diagrams of this Q shape, which is some sort of combinatorial collection, and a product of hook lengths. So 1 by product of hook lengths S in this diagram. So it's like a nice sum over, even in my discussion with Arvind, he had said, it's like, it's all positive now. There's no negativity that it makes it easy for us to deal with it. Now, I propose that the same thing could be used. So this is where I was trying to say that C lambda nu, which I had just mentioned here, could be used to derive one such formula. So what is the formula? What am I blabbering? So I'm just saying, hey, S lambda. I'll finally come to the number theoretic thing. Okay. Delta x square, and then I replace this by a sum over I replace this thing by this, and then I integrate it out. So this is, of course, we have nice formulas for these two. We have nice product hook length formulas, if you like, for this. So what I propose is that, of course, SYT, at least in this special case where you have a whole huge square sitting inside this Q shape, you will be able to get a hook length formula of this sort. Now the question is, which I have left unanswered, is we only dealt with S lambda. Why didn't we ever go to M lambda, H lambda, C lambda? Maybe next time. I haven't really seen it much in literature. Of course, there is our Motto's integral, which is for a single ER and HR, PR, all for single values, well known. I'm not very sure if these huger symmetric functions have nice Selberg integrals. I haven't seen it yet. And we had seen that, of course, in the infinity case, of course, this is M lambda. But infinity doesn't work well with delta x to the power infinity, I mean, whatever, 1 by to the power 0. So that's like tightly linked with the power of the delta in the integral. So this alone is not going to give us those integrals that we look forward to, which is the m lambda delta x square or h lambda. That is left unanswered. So now let me just go on to that final step, which I was referring to, why I bothered about this. So now if you instead look at the number theory, so if you instead look at this determinant, now I'm going to do a double integral. I'm going to integrate out the y also. So let me just, for time being, just say, and now this, at this stage, the only dependence on I and j is well known, as Arvin had asked. So if you had just integrated out, what do we expect? So what we do expect is, by all these above manipulations, we can get it in terms of, of course, there's a 1 by n factorial square and all that, but you have a delta x square, delta y square, product ij 1 minus xi yj dx dy. So this is the same way we can derive it. Do we know about this? So I was going to tell you that it is related to some sort of, so when we expand it in terms of lambda, so we have a sum over lambda, and we have it. So we can express this, can be thought of as a special value of a hypergeometric function with Jack polynomial argument. I'll just leave it there, because what is the value of it in this to this lecture is just that, okay, special values of hypergeometric functions seem to have nice product formula. Is equal to nice product. This is what I would love to get. And separately there are results by what's it called? Pateev, the same Pateev from conformal field theory, but this is a little earlier, 90s or 80s, I think. That if you have a different sort of let me just write it down. So if you have, I'll just write it in a simpler fashion. Alpha prime 1 minus pi I beta prime minus 1, they probably don't write this. So they just leave it without any writing. And this delta, instead of delta, what they have is, this is the most important thing, is this modulus xi minus yj. Let's say. If it makes sense for them, it's all conformal field theory. They'll take the principal value, blah, blah, blah. But they, in fact, if you can think of the 0, 1, and 1 infinity also, let me just take a bit, do this. So what they have is this indeed has a nice product formula. They have found it. So what I would say is, when there is a restriction, some bound between connection between when alpha is something related to alpha prime, beta is something like beta prime. So unfortunately, the situation in which we are in, if you take a change of variable xi going to 1 by xi, you might get to that stage, but actually this is not it. This is wrong actually. There's a delta x and there's a delta y to the 2 gamma and 2 gamma prime. So there is a lot of stuff. It's a huge integral. So from the 90s conformal field theory, they have gone much further ahead to n-fold products, etc. Right now, this they have proved that it has a nice product formula when there is special relation between alpha. Unfortunately, that relation does not hold in this case when you do a change of variable also. So I'll still leave it as a question mark. We are not sure if it has a nice product, but for those, again, experts here who have seen this, so this is a very special value of a hypergeometric function, just F21 sort of hypergeometric function. Therefore, we expect not F21, F43 or something, but to have a nice product. Okay, but what does it have relation to number theory? So the number theory, quickly, what we can conclude is, this is a nice polynomial f in zeta of 2. So that's the part where the irrationality theory has come. I have run out of time. If I can take a few more minutes, I'll just complete this connection. Amri?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. So basically, this is coming from due to Bucher's, this integral itself is due to Bucher's 79 or something, or really totally related to the work by Apéry, again 78-79. And what they have, Bucher's, this integral is due to Bucher's. This is how I have arrived at this in the first place. Is some integer in 2. So this is a rational number. This is an integer. for time being, that's all we really need to know. We even have a nice bound on the denominator. Sorry, that was my dog. She's got extremely excited. I could not have said no. Now, now that we know, I mean, there's a nice bound on the denominator also, how huge the denominator can be. That plays a role later on. For the time being, all we need to know is each entry is a linear polynomial, if you like, in zeta of 2. So in basically Q of zeta of 2. It's a polynomial of degree n with rational coefficients in zeta of 2. And what we have been able to prove using the other, that summation argument, this, what I mean is, argument. So I have a nice summation over k. This, all these become squares actually, this goes off. And I am able to estimate, and from whatever I could produce, I do conclude that, Ravi, here only. So we do conclude. So estimate f of zeta of 2 is 2n square. Let's just put it this way. Plus little log of n log n. Anyway, log n. Okay. If you can get it, we are able to estimate that it decays like really rapidly, and it's not zero. Again, from that nice product formula, or from the nice sum over squares, sum over positive terms, we are able to conclude it's not zero either. And that gives you that theta 2 is irrational. So the denominator is very important here. It's not enough that if it was an integer, integer polynomial that went to zero, that would have been enough for us. But it's a rational polynomial, so we need to multiply by the denominators to make it integer. That's where this decay plays an important role. So the crux of the argument is this part. Everything else was well known to Bucher and Napieri. This argument seems to be new, and there are variations to zeta 3, zeta 4, etc. But what is the big deal? The big deal is, would have been if we had a nice product formula, we would be able to estimate it by the snap of our fingers. But we don't have it right now. I am hopeful that there is one such thing. That is the connection to, and okay, how do we find that nice product formula? By all the methods that we have seen till now. As in, Thierry's rule and several such rules. Theoretically, it can be done, but how to do it is a question. So I stop now. Thank you for your patience.
Wow, that's really interesting. Let's thank Krishnan. You can just unmute your mics and clap, as is the custom here. How do you know that S lambda 1 minus xi has non-negative Schur expansion, Schur polynomial?
I don't know. I don't know for sure. What I was trying to hint at some argument here, that it's actually the, but when I wrote it down, it's coming out to be the matrix for which I knew is eigenfunction. I was trying to get it the other way. The
what is this
the,
I knew, by the way?
I knew is this integral, sorry. This integral. Okay, yeah. The Kedel integral or whatever integral at lambda is actually the sum over the lambda of these integrals. So,
you're saying because of that, you think?
No. This is not the. No, this seems to be that.
Sorry, Krishnan. I just checked. Whether these are non-negative, and they're not.
They're not. Okay. Sorry.
Yeah, so I computed some small examples there. Of course, they're all integers, but...
They're all integers.
Yeah, but that's clear because...
That's clear because of this one.
Because you're taking S lambda of 1 minus X.
So the expansion would have fine. Thank you. That's not the
It would seem reason. Very surprising if they were non-negative. Unlike Arvind, I didn't actually.
No. Yeah. So I'm sure you can check. I would need your help actually in checking a little bit further. Maybe I will contact you.
But if they're not non-negative, then we are not interested.
No, then you are not interested in that argument. I have other arguments. See, what is the ideal? I mean, we would like to have hook length formula for the, we as in everybody in the world would like to have nice hook length formulas for skew shapes. That part is well known. And they have been dealing with this Naru's formula, which has its positive and negative aspects, but we would like to have a lot more. So the main thing is if m lambdas, if you can express the integral of m lambda delta x square as a nice product, then definitely we know that those coefficients are positive. We know the coefficients, so we can calculate them by hand. So if S lambda, basically, forget about 1 minute. Oh yeah, 1 minute.
You cannot expect a hook. You cannot expect a hook length formula for skew shapes. I mean, this is well known.
No. As a sum over, as in whatever I was saying, this. Where did I write it? Yeah, this one. It's not a simple hook length.
Yeah, but Narusa is the best you can do. I mean, it's.
As in, best as in.
I mean, because there's no other. There's no other known formula for. Positive sum. Of hook products.
No. I agree that it's the only known one, but there could be other ones also.
Yeah, of course there could be anything, but I'm just saying. And this is very recent, as you know. I mean, until now there was no positive formula for.
Exactly. So no, what I'm trying to say is, I mean, if I'm not being clear, is I'm trying to derive many such formulas, all using these expansions of S lambda S. New 1 minus x in terms of other known symmetric functions for which we can actually sit and calculate as a hook length. So again, it may not be a hook length, but it may be a nice product as we see here. This is a nice product. You may or may not agree that this is a hook length formula, but this sort of formulas also would do for us for as a sum of positive things is what you had.
Yeah, sure.
So this is a philosophy I was trying. If you could express S nu 1 minus x in terms of other known.
Okay.
They're not positive. Okay. I will check. No. I'll get back to you with some other conjecture.
Yeah, sure. No. What is possible is that this C lambda nu could have nice properties. And the matrix of. Other thing I forgot to tell you. When I was doing the experiment is to realize that S lambda of 1 minus x is not homogeneous. So when you take S lambda.
Yeah, you'll get all lower.
You'll get all lower.
Yes.
So it's not like a matrix of size, the partition.
But one thing may be true, right? Arvind, is it alternating in the co-degree? I mean, it's the degree difference. The terms will be positive or negative depending on the difference in the degrees, right?
Sorry, I missed you, Amri. What did you say?
I'm wondering if the terms will be positive. The C lambda nu, the sign will only depend on the degree of lambda and size of lambda and size of nu. Maybe not.
Fine. No, this may be a bad question, but there might be better questions actually. So I will come up with.
I can give you an example.
Mm-hmm.
So I took the partition 2, 1
mm-hmm.
in 3 variables and I did this expansion and I get 8 times 1 minus 8 times S1 plus 4 times S11 plus 2 times S2. Minus S21.
So the signs are alternating in the degrees, right?
Maybe. Yeah, it's possible that that's true. So I have to do more thorough investigation to confirm. but that's
fine. No, that's fine. This I totally agree.
Operation is simpler in terms of power sum symmetric functions, I guess. If you just take pk of 1 minus x, then it is summation of 1 minus xi. You can write it down as an alternating sum of power sum symmetric functions with binomial coefficients in front. And sometimes
alternating again, see, as Arvind had said, we want somehow positive coefficients would have been ideal.
No, I don't know. Like,
anyway,
some of
this is not super nice because you are getting all lower order terms, so that's part of the problem with this.
No, that's just a single power sum. If you take a power sum symmetric function as a product of p lambda 1, p lambda 2, then it will probably become.
Then you'll get a whole bunch of.
Then you'll get again get everything below.
Yeah, you'll get all lower terms. You'll get the products of binomial coefficients.
But sums of those.
I don't know. Some of these problems are easier to look at in terms of power sum symmetric functions. I wonder if this is possible.
But if you put x plus 1 instead of 1 minus x, is that obviously positive in terms of the, is that sure positive? S lambda x plus 1?
Krishnan has vanished.
Oh. Yes. He must have lost connection. Let's see if he joins again. Ah, there he is. He's back.
You're muted, Krishnan.
Okay. There was a power cut. Sorry. Did I miss something?
Vishwanath was saying, why not 1 plus x?
Why not 1 plus x? No, there's such, that symmetry is not there in the integration. Though I'm not sure if...
No, just out of curiosity.
Okay.
I mean, yeah.
Curiosity. Okay, sorry.
No, just a positivity. Is that sure positive?
Yeah, that should be sure.
That.
Is it obvious that it should be sure positive?
I can check again. I'm reasonably sure. Yeah, all the negatives here will become positive.
That's... Sign is something very controllable, right? That's the whole point.
You know
the sign. So I don't think. It's a very predictable sign. It just depends on the difference of the degrees, probably. So.
Mm-hmm. I will get back to you regarding that. But yeah, there's this other thing also. What would be the integrals involving the p lambdas and the m lambda, h lambda, e lambda, everything? I haven't really been able to find it. So what they do, of course, they have calculated for the single one, single part formulas. They are all available. I haven't seen the higher one yet.
Sorry, say that again. What is more?
No, e lambda 1 into lambda 2. It's almost like taking a product of Schur's function. If you like.
Lambda. What
no, the integral of e lambda delta x square. For the higher partition. I mean, higher number of parts. ER is Air Motor's integral. But beyond that.
I see E lambda.
Yeah.
But it seems to be something. No, I would say it's easier. Easy. Should have been easier to do. E lambda.
Our
motor is only for ER, EK. I mean, one integer. One part partition.
But some further generalization in
I will check time. Actually. Which I said.
Maybe I misunderstood. Yeah.
No. I would say this product which I wrote down was all that I have seen in this conformal field theory setup.
Okay, I have to leave. Thanks, Krishna.
Thanks a lot. I will contact you with conjectures if any. Thank you. Bye.
Okay, so I guess we'll bring Krishna.
Hi. Hello.
This is Rini.
Hi. Okay.
Hi. So, How far you are able to generalize it now for irrationality of zetas values?
No, it's only come to zeta,
zeta
of 2.
Zeta 3.
Only zeta 3, zeta of 2.
Could you?
No, not yet.
So zeta 3 is still.
Actually, what I was telling that Nehru's hook length formula, etc., I used, but it was not sufficing for my purpose. So I would like a better hook length formula. Now I can't really hear recording. But anyway, Arvind said that is the best one that is available right now, and it's recent also. So I would always like to improve upon the hook length formula to get better results. To zeta 3, even I have not been able to.
Okay. It's long-standing problem, right?
long-standing. But no, what would solve the problem in one stroke if it has a nice product formula. Complete. That whole determinant has a nice product formula. Initially, I was not believing that would happen, but there is too much evidence actually that there is a nice product. And no, I forgot
once
to tell
zeta
you.
Zeta 3 is done.
No, more than
once you
irrationality, I wanted to tell this also. See, if you change the integral, I'll just share screen once again. Suppose you're recording, but.
No, I can stop it.
You can.